Yesterday, we began with looking at the divine feminine, in particular, another aspect of the divine feminine.
Eitai.
Okay, I'm going to begin here. And I'm going to start out with this video. I'll just play a portion of it, but this is going to set the stage for what we're talking about. We're going to cover today.
Okay.
It's all right to tap your foot, y'all, you know, and sing along silently if y'all, I know some of y'all want to. Nobody catching the Holy Ghost while we're doing this, interrupting the record and shouting and speaking in tongues and doing all that kind of stuff. So we're going to circle on back, family, to the subject at hand. We're taking a look at the second chapter of the Gospel of John, and it is the marriage at Cana, the marriage at Cana, right? It is the scene from an within the allegorical narrative of the New Testament Gospels. It's the scene and the setting of Jesus's supposed first miracle, okay? Changing the water into wine. And we talked about that yesterday. We went through that. We will not review or repeat what we went over yesterday. We set the groundwork for the ancient understanding and translating of each of the symbols. All right. And we won't revisit that now. We want to concentrate on one element, one particular element in the narrative. Actually, we're gonna look at several, but one in particular. And that is the wine, family. That is the wine. And we know that in the scriptures, that wine is symbolic for what? In the New Testament scriptures, wine correlates or corresponds to what?
The blood.
Blood. Very good. Very good. So if you're taking notes, write down the word blood. That's why we looked at the video, power in the blood. And as I was saying before, that many of us look at this and we look at that video and we kind of, you know, maybe not consciously, but maybe unconsciously, we look down our noses at those deceived, ignorant Christians singing about power in the blood. And again, we say, you know, they're deceived, and, you know, we have a higher understanding of blood, you know, as Hebrew Israelites, as, you know, awakened and aware, higher consciousness individuals. And we, and in doing so, we say that there is no power in the blood, you know, to bless like they're singing about and rejoicing about, but that the blood curses, correct? And this is demonstrated, it is illustrated in the Hebrew, Israelite, and Jewish custom of separation during that time, that the females, because they are cursed, you know, we don't say it like that, but it is implicit, because they are cursed, that they can't have any, you know, during their time of menstruation, that they can't have any contact with either their spouse or their children. They can't cook. They can't, you know, participate in any of the traditions and any of the kagim. You know, definitely not any of the holy days. They have to be separate. Why? Because they're cursed. Just to say it plainly. But we're going to find out today as we search these things out that we're just as deceived as those Christians. And even more so, they are closer to the truth of the matter than we are and that we have been. So let's take a look at this first verse of John 2, because as I said before, it is loaded. It is literally pregnant, pun intended. It is literally pregnant with meaningful symbols, pun intended, because we are concentrating on the divine feminine. And we have to renovate and resurrect the image of the divine feminine. And the third day, there was a marriage in Cana. And we said yesterday, previously, that this word Cana is in the Strong's Concordance, H7071, derived from H7069. In the Hebrew, translated as reed, stalk, bone, shaft, and measuring rod. Now, there are several applicable symbolic meanings in there. It just does not mean one. It can mean all of these things. We're going to concentrate on human physiology today in searching this thing out. So what I want you all to concentrate on, because This was done purposely by our ancestors. Concentrate on bone, especially bone. Concentrate on two shaft and bone being a tube or a shaft. All right. Now, it goes on to say of this marriage wedding ceremony that the mother of Jesus was there. Another powerful symbol, Miriam. All right. Mary or Miriam, another powerful symbol with multiple layers of application. We're going to concentrate on just one today. All right. Mary, in this sense, is a conduit or a possessor and conduit. We're going to look at Mary as a possessor of something and a conduit of something. That she was, in fact, the embodiment or contained from a physical standpoint, a tube, a reed, a tube, or a shaft. And we know that this to be the tube that is associated with the mother, or the reed that is associated with the mother, is the umbilical cord. Write that down. Bone and umbilical cord. Among other things, a mother as a possessor of something, and as both a possessor of something and a conduit through the umbilical cord, transfers mitochondrial DNA and melanin to her offspring. Is everyone with me?
Wow.
Is everyone with me?
Yeah, I'm with you.
we would say it like this, that the blood of the mother everything that is in the blood of the mother, the life of the mother, is transferred, right, to that offspring.
Right.
To that fruit of the womb. Now, I'm using a multitude of metaphors here purposefully because our ancestors gave it to us that way. So that, Nasik, when we would reach this point of holism, that the different metaphors would not confuse us.
Right.
We would find a way, and we would, or a better way of saying that is we would possess the ability at that point to see similarities.
Right.
Instead of differences. And we would begin to develop that ability, that capability, that power of seeing holistically, which means seeing the similarities in things so that we could what? Not separate them, but reunite them.
Right.
Because the essential nature of everything is wholeness. Separation, division, duality, family, is deception.
Absolutely.
Manifested. So if we are, for any reason, separating ourselves from one another, we're deceived. For any reason.
This is what you call self-deception here.
That's correct. I'll repeat that, family. If we are compelled to or are separating ourselves or dividing ourselves for any reason, including a woman menstruating every month. That is the manifestation of deception, because truth is embodied in wholeness, in coming together, uniting, syncretizing. I know I've said something. Continuing on. Follow me, family. The lotus flower, write down the word flower and the word bloom, B-L-O-O-M. It looks like blood with an M on the end instead of a D. Write down the word flower. Next to it, write down the word bloom. And next to it, write down the word blood. The lotus flower, the radiant yellow center of the Egyptian blue lotus, resembles the sun emanating from primeval waters, as told in the myth of creation. At night, the flower closes and sinks under the water. At dawn, it rises and opens up again. According to the Egyptian creation myth, it was a giant lotus, which is a giant flower, which rose out of the watery chaos at the beginning. From this giant lotus, the sun itself rose. And when you write the word sun, write S-U-N-S-O-N, the fruit of the womb, what the mother carries, and through the umbilical cord, feeds and nourishes the sun with her blood, with her life, with her essence. Are you all with me?
Now that makes sense when you say the blood is the life of the flesh.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Leviticus 17 and 11.
Right. We're going to go back to the so-called Old Testament now, see, and prove all of this. That the sun itself rose on the first day. Both the blue and white varieties were used, listen, in medicinal preparation. Write that down. Healing in the blood. Healing in the blood. Healing in the flower. Healing in the umbilical cord. Healing in the bone. In mathematics, the lotus hieroglyph symbolized the number 1,000, which is a multiple of 10, which is equated through the tetrarchus with Christ, through gematria, with Christ. It is also symbolic of Upper Egypt and represents the resurrection of Isis. Write down resurrection power in the blood. Don't that sound like that church song that them dumb Christians, that those deceived Christians were singing about?
Yeah.
Continuing on. The Old Testament of Moses parting the Red Sea, it's actually the Red Sea is not a bad mistranslation, Nasi. Uh-huh. But it's actually the Reed Sea. It means the same. It means essentially right. The same thing.
Right.
It means essentially the same thing once we get into this. But that's correct. Red being the color of blood is most appropriate. And the color of wine being most appropriate. Remember, the Cana was where the water, Red Sea, was turned into what? Wine.
Wine.
So Red Sea is appropriate. And Cana, meaning reed seed, is appropriate as well. Do y'all see how holism does not try to find opposition, but to find harmony in all things?
Yes, yes.
And the rod of God corresponds with the Egyptian ideas about the field of reeds and the Jed pillar. We talked about the Jed pillar yesterday. We're going to put that off for now. Again, we're not going to repeat it. We're going to go back into more detail in later sessions and lock all of this in. As such, the story of the parting of the reed or the Red Sea, listen, family, is easily interpreted as an allegory for the opening of the field and the dimension of the blessed. There's blessing in the blood. Are you all with me?
Yes, sir.
We have to change and transition, family, from the old paradigm, from the old pattern, from the old traditions, traditional ways of seeing things, traditional ways of believing things, traditional ways of understanding and thinking about things. If we're going to ascend, if we're going to not seek, assess, or possess the knowledge that is right, going to allow us to ascend. It is highly significant that Cana, meaning reedy, is the place where Jesus performed his first miracle, turning the water into wine at the wedding feast, demonstrating his magical ability. Listen, family, because this is going to involve the Jed pillar when we go back to it and its function to interact with other dimensional sacred reality. We're trying to contact heaven, family. We're trying to not see return.
Right.
To wholeness, to divinity. So turning the water into wine at a wedding feast, demonstrating his ability to interact with the other dimensional sacred reality. We all have that ability. Or to alter this one. That's definitely what I'm trying to, what I'm doing. Not trying.
Yeah.
It's what I'm doing. Allowing my will, which is in heaven, my intent, which is in heaven, connected to my higher consciousness, to my higher self, to be done, to manifest in earth. In early Christian art, Jesus, in the role of the Redeemer, phonetically, Redeemer. Now, y'all see the word reed in there?
Yeah, right.
Come on. Is repeatedly shown performing this miracle and all others. It is very important. He has a rod or a wand in his hand. What is this wand? Where did he get it? What is the rod made of? What happened to it? This writer says, I've wondered about this for a very long time. We showed you yesterday what that rod was. Do y'all see it? Can you all see it on the screen?
Yeah.
Okay.
Cain.
All right. You remember we showed you what that rod was. This is very important as we move forward. All right. The reed symbol next appears as a prominent tool in the crucifixion. So we won't go over that right now, but we will go over that later because it's important. We just want to follow this trail of blood, all right? We just want to follow this trail of blood. Now, think with me now, relative to these miracles that Jesus did with food, what were some of the main elements that he worked with? I'll tell you. Fish and bread, right?
Right.
Feeding what? The 5,000.
Right.
Fish, bread, water, and wine, correct?
Right.
Write those things down. Fish, bread, water, and wine. And I want you all to put a fifth element down, blood. Fish, bread, water, wine, and blood. Five things, five elements. Write that down. Five things, five elements. Now, see, this fits together so well with everything that we've been talking about.
Yeah.
We're going to go to the first chapter of the Song of Solomon, the Song of Songs. And we're going to concentrate in this study. We're going to return and we're going to draw things from both the first and second chapter of the Song of Songs, Song of Solomon. And we're reading from the first to the sixth verse. The Song of Songs, which is Solomon's. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. For thy love is better than wine. It's better than wine. It's a higher concept than wine. Higher concept than the blood. It's talking about something on a cosmic or energetic or emotional level. And it involves passionate interaction. Remember what we talked about yesterday, between the male and the female, between masculine and feminine elements. This is science. This is not no love letter or no love song. This is about divine alchemical science, family. Because of the savor of thy good ointments, the savor of thy good ointments, thy name is as thy name is as ointment poured forth. Now, write that down. Ointment or liquid. Poured forth, gushing forth. bursting forth. Therefore do the virgins love thee. Draw me, we will run after thee. The king hath brought me into his chambers. We will be glad and rejoice in thee. That we will be glad and rejoice in it. Does that sound familiar to someone?
Yeah.
Come on now, come on.
Yeah.
We will remember thy love more than wine. The upright love thee. This is full. We're going to come back and decode this. This is full of instructions. Scientific alchemical instructions for us. But just for now, we want to follow this. We will be glad and rejoice in thee. We will remember thy love, not learn about it. We will remember thy love more than wine. The upright love thee. I am black. They have but comely. I'm going to say and comely. O ye daughters of Jerusalem, as the tents of Kedar, as the curtains of Solomon. That's referring to melanin, which is transferred from the mother to the fruit of the womb via the umbilical cord, via the blood. And in that seed, now see, is more fruit and more seed.
Yes.
Genesis 1 and 11, family. It ain't talking about no diet like that.
Mm-hmm.
The bread, the fish, the wine, the water, blood is not talking about something that you consume physically. Look not upon me, because I am black. Listen, you know it's talking about melanin, because the sun have looked upon me. We know the relationship between melanin and the sun, family.
Yeah.
From a physical earth vantage point. My mother's children were angry with me. Why? They made me keeper of the vineyard. Listen, but my own vineyard have I kept not. Have I not kept? The Christians got more knowledge than us about this vineyard. How, again, do you turn that from a physical standpoint? Is water turned into wine? We said it. It is drawn up through the root. And through the root is taken, that water is taken to the vine, correct?
Yeah.
And then transferred into the fruit, where it's the juice or the ointment or the oil within the fruit. Are you all with me?
Mm-hmm.
That is done by the feminine aspect of the vine. But the confession is that they made me keeper of the vineyards, but my own vineyard have I not kept. I'm going to show you how, Nasi, we have not retained, because we have not retained the knowledge, sacred knowledge of self, we have not kept our own vineyard.
Knock on.
We are the keepers of the vineyard. We are not only the keepers of the vineyard, we are the true vine.
Absolutely, right.
So we talked about how this Hieros Gamos the sacred marriage between two divinities was the actual setting of the allegorical tale of the marriage of Cana. All scripture, the biblical scripture, the source code for the biblical scripture family is divine sexual union and reunion. The source code for understanding the Bible is the perception that everything in the allegorical narrative is related to divine separation of the masculine and feminine elements in the descent. We read the descent of Inanna yesterday, which corresponds to the descent, the Gnostic tale of the descent of Sophia. You all with me? And how we became separated into genders during that epic fall. And the desire has always been what? To remarry, to reunite, so that the underlying source code of all script of the biblical narrative, as well as the vast majority of sacred spiritual traditions, spiritual knowledge, and spiritual texts, is sexual union, the union of the divine masculine with the divine feminine, the reunion, actually, Nasi. So therefore, mercy and truth need to meet together. Righteousness and peace need to kiss each other. Moving forward, following this blood theme, okay? John, we'll go over it again. 1 John 5:7-8. Syncretizing, Nasik, all of the appropriate correlative scriptures into one holistic thought. For there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. These three are one. However, and this is important, there are three that bear witness in earth. And again, if you're taking notes, write it down. The Spirit, the water, and the blood. And it says these three agree, not as one, in one. And we went on to prove yesterday, and we'll reinforce that today and reconfirm it today, that that one that these three agree in is the divine feminine, and in the biological makeup of females. We know that this scripture is talking about Jesus Christ, a male. But the Jesus Christ figure in every aspect is based on a divine feminine allegorical character. The old paradigm, old traditions, the old pattern, the old template biases us towards a patriarchal interpretation of things. And this has affected women severely, profoundly in our traditions, which Nasik are backwards in many cases. Inverted. Right. We'll prove it. For as much as ye know that we were redeemed we were not redeemed rather with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by the tradition of your fathers. There it is. But with the precious blood of Christ. Well, I won't even get into it. It is precious. The blood is precious. As of a lamb. Now I'm going to write this word, you lamb. All right? I'll prove that. I know what traditions say, Nasi. That is supposed to be what? A male without spot or blemishes. Am I not correct?
That's right.
Okay.
But I'll prove it because the ewe lamb is Raquel.
Yes.
I'll just give you all a heads up. And if you want to research this within the allegory, go right ahead. Do the etymology. The ewe lamb in Hebrew is Raquel. We'll go on. Who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but is being manifest in these last times for you. I'm going to prove that statement now, see. I'm going to prove it. Everything that I'm telling you is verifiable, and as we go through the study, it's going to become apparent what it is that I'm saying and why I'm taking the position that I'm taking. But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, that is Jesus, and forthwith came there out blood and water. Now, we noticed yesterday that Kava, Eve, according to the narrative, was taken from where? Out of Adam's side, correct? One of his ribs. So this piercing and the water in the book is a direct reference to the feminine aspect.
Mm-hmm.
She is the only one that produces the water and the blood, that produces the wine, that produces the bread, that possesses the fish.
Yes. Yes. Okay, so
it says that this blood and water did what? Came out, gushed forth. Are you
mm-hmm.
all
right? Mm-hmm.
And they shall take the blood and strike it on the two side posts, the upper posts of the houses, wherein they shall what? Eat it.
Mm-hmm.
All with it, food, water, blood, fish, eating it. Blood. Let's look at the etymological definition. It's the fluid, as we know, that circulates in the arteries and the veins. It perhaps means to swell, gush, or spurt out. Did we see that in the narrative?
Yeah.
Okay. Follow me, family. Follow me. That which burst out. As far as a woman's menstruation, isn't that blood bursting to the outside of the body?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Follow me, family.
Okay.
Come on.
Now, it says from the Gothic, blood, meaning blood, flower, write down flower.
Mm-hmm.
It means to thrive, not to die, not to be cursed, but to thrive or bloom.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, Nasi, that the giant lotus of the Egyptian tradition would rise out of the water every morning when the sun would rise, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Then it would go down at night. So just let me ask you, when the sun goes down, what comes up? When the greater light goes,
the moon.
Greater light goes, write the word moon down. Write the word moon down. Does the moon have anything to do with a woman's cycle?
Absolutely.
Moon means moon, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
In the Hebrew, write this down. Moon also means sin.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to show you how they inverted this, Nasi.
Mm-hmm.
Moon also means sin. Don't trust me. Research it yourself as well. It is related in the Sumerian tradition to Nanar Sin, who is related to Inanna.
Mm-hmm.
There seems to have been an avoidance in Germanic, perhaps from taboo, of other PIE words for blood, such as Esen, so Eser, Eshar, Crew, which seems to have had a sense of blood outside of the body. Gore from a womb. Blood from a womb. But a woman is not wounded when the blood comes forth. It is a natural, organic cycle.
Yes.
Blood outside of the body, family. It also means inheritance, as we said, and relationship. Person of one's family, kindred, offspring, referring to the fruit of the womb. The fruit of the womb. Also, the fluid of life. Life in the blood. The fluid of life, power in the blood. Now, who sounds deceived now?
Mm-hmm.
And the presumed seat of the passions or the emotions. Is this relating to everything that we've taught about thus far, family, recently?
Can shows.
Come on. And has stood for the temper of the mind. It relates directly to your consciousness level. And your disposition. Emotional disposition, conscious disposition, mental disposition. In slang, it means a hot spark, a man of fire, an illuminated man, not from a physical standpoint, which we've been locked into under the low frequency, negative, patriarchal field of dominance, family. I'm going to pause here and ask, are there any questions or comments? All right, moving on. Again, John laid this thing, the scripture lays this concept out in John, the 6th chapter, 26 through 66. And we went over that yesterday. We'll go over it at a later time. But I want to get to the heart of this as quickly as possible. So we want to lay this thing down, and we'll go back to many of these things. So this idea, the eternal idea of these eternal symbols, fish, bread, water, wine, and blood. The eternal idea gives us an eternal understanding, an eternal organic concept of these terms and how they relate to ourselves, because the ultimate wisdom is to know yourself. So we're going to focus on the biological aspects again, blood, and continue to follow this through. The etymology of the name of the goddess Nana, which is related to Inanna or Inanna, is debated. Some scholars have proposed that the name may derive from a Babel word Nana, as we say, meaning mother. And remember, the mother of Jesus in the narrative of John, the 2nd chapter, the marriage at Cana, that we broke down the symbology of the mother of Jesus, relating to the umbilical cord, relating to being a possessor of life, and through the physical process of embryology, passing life onto the child through the umbilical cord, passing the blood of the mother and the blood of the father to the fruit of the womb, the child, the offspring, through the umbilical cord, that tool, that tube, that reed, that shaft, all right, that is primary in physical reproduction. Scholar Jan DeVries connects the name Nana to the root Na, leading to the daring one. In Old Norse, Nana roughly meant woman. And again, Nana may have once meant she who empowers or she who gives life. It means both of those things. It means both of those things. So we're seeing she who empowers. We're getting closer to our understanding that there is power in the blood. So We said that it was observed, rather, that when Yeshua performed all of his miracles, he had this reed or rod in his hand. And even Moses, parting of the Red Sea, you know, that he had this rod there. And it was central in the biblical narrative as being symbolic of what? The power of God. When Moses went, was commissioned, or called to go to speak to Pharaoh to free the children of Israel who were in bondage, you know, he hesitated and, you know, what sign shall I show them that you're with me? What do you have in your hand? A rod. Cast it on the ground, and it turned into a serpent, correct?
Okay.
And all of the miracles were performed with that rod. It's symbolic of the omnipotence of divine power. The omnipotence of divine power. We look at it primarily because we have been biased in terms of the profound patriarchal system that we incarnated in this age, that we've been convinced that this rod represents the male phallus. Am I not?
Right. Okay, so
let's find out what the truth is. Let's find out what the truth is. The knot of Inanna is a stylized bundle of reeds, an emblem of the Babylonian goddess Inanna. This symbol was the early written form of the name of the goddess, whose name was composed of two characters, the post and the ring of rushes. Now remember, the blood was placed on the doorposts, right?
Yes, yes.
Went through that, the three posts. Was it to curse somebody or destroy somebody or keep destruction from the people that did it? It was protective, correct?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Let's continue on. It is related to the Tayat knot of Isis, the Tayat knot of Isis, a symbol of divine authority and power. It is the ancestor of the crozier, the staff carried by the male Catholic bishops. So of course we would think the staff was referring to the divine masculine element, right?
Mm-hmm.
Not so. Not so. So the Tayat knot we found resembled the Ankh with the bent arms. The Tayat or girdle of Isis is found mainly in Egyptian funerary murals. It most likely represents, look, the flow of menstrual blood from the womb of the goddess. Something that gushes forth, that bursts forth. Is everybody still with me?
Absolutely.
And its magical properties. Well, a lot of y'all say, well, this is just, you know, couldn't that just be superstition, you know, of an ignorant people? They didn't know. These were heathens. You're talking about the Egyptians.
Mm-hmm.
Old paradigm, family.
Mm-hmm.
Old paradigm. Old beliefs that we likely have never even searched out.
Eitai.
Yes.
This Tayat knot. Could this European taking that science? Well, they let me retract that, because they have taken our science for their benefit. And the tie that they wear in their clothing,
the bow tie,
and the regular necktie that you tie into a knot,
absolutely,
mm-hmm, around their neck,
absolutely,
around the throat chakra,
absolutely. When you get what? Dressed up.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Follow me now. You're right. These are, it's a reflection of the garments of gods. The garments of the Egyptian gods. And I'll explain why this type of bolo tie is prominent in the West.
Mm-hmm.
and especially in the Southwest.
Yes.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
The garments of the Egyptian gods, which the Tiatnat is one, are frequently depicted with belts in such configuration. The power of the Tiat is described in a spell in the papyrus of Ani. The blood of Isis, the spells of Isis, the magical words of Isis. That's why you wear the tie, yat, the tayet, mm-hmm. around your mm-hmm. neck.
Mm-hmm.
Power you. That's why a preacher
mm-hmm.
wears the tayet. That's why the black Muslims wear mm-hmm. the bow tie.
Mm-hmm.
Shall keep this great or shining one strong, and shall protect him whosoever would harm him, do to him such things as he abominateth. Look, this is all tied to the Old Testament, putting the blood on the lintels of the doorposts.
Mm-hmm.
Are y'all hearing me? It was
absolutely
blood of menstruation. It was the blood of the ewe lamb. Hard to hear, I know.
And Eitai, you know, just thinking what you just said, now I see why, looking at Trump, why he always wear red tie.
Well, yeah, that's the power tie. That's the power tie.
Mm-hmm.
The bloody.
Yes.
The bloody menstrual cloth.
Mm-hmm.
The bloody tie-at knot. Y'all don't believe me. Prove me wrong. Prove me wrong. Y'all already know this.
Come on, shows.
Didn't we just have a blood moon?
Mm-hmm.
I'm just going to let that sink in. If y'all think I'm making this stuff up, didn't we just have a blood moon?
Yes, we did.
We did.
Which was the longest total lunar eclipse of the century,
mm-hmm.
which was on July 27th, which began this tremendously powerful transition
yes.
into August 8th through the 13th, the opening
yes.
and closing of the Lion's Gate. I'm going to tie all this together.
Come on, Sheriff.
The blood moon. Doesn't the moon have something to do with female menstruation?
Absolutely.
It's why we got, yes. we're taking this time period to renovate and resurrect the image of the divine feminine. It's time yeah. for it.
Yes.
We'll not move forward under the old paradigm. Nobody on here will move forward, will ascend any higher, holding on to the old paradigm.
Yes.
This was demonstrated with the blood moon.
Mm-hmm.
And you held it up there for the longest period so that it can get your attention.
Mm-hmm.
Hello, wake up, blood
yes.
moon. Longest total lunar eclipse of the 21st century. We got to end this nonsense about
yes.
blood and about
yes.
sin and about a curse
mm-hmm.
being tied to your divinity, sisters, daughters, mothers, brothers.
Yes.
The the total phase of the blood moon eclipse of July 22nd lasted 1 hour, 43 minutes, during which Earth's natural satellite will turn a spectacular red or ruddy brown color. And we saw, did we see the depictions of it?
Okay.
It was spectacular. From start to finish, the entire celestial event will last nearly 4 hours. The eclipse, listen, won't be visible to viewers in North America. Mm-hmm. I'll tie all this together, family. This mm-hmm. is all so significant.
Mm-hmm.
But observers in much of Africa, the Middle East,
Come on. Right.
Southern Asia and the mm-hmm. Indian Ocean region will get an eyeful, given cooperative weather, according to lunar scientist Noah Petro. This is funny. I come across these names that are meaningful. I don't think these people exist. Every time they have a story like this, the person has a name that I can
right.
put into the study.
Right.
I don't believe it.
It's Noah ancestor Petro. Shows.
Noah Petro. Look, Noah.
Right.
Noah was involved in the Noah's Ark. Was that a transitional period?
Absolutely.
Did it involve a dove?
Absolutely.
Did it involve water?
Absolutely.
Did it involve a rock, a Petro?
Absolutely.
Come on now. Come on, family. This is just, I see this too much.
Too much. Yes.
I had asked the family yesterday, and we talked about this before, to tell me what the body is cleansing itself of during a woman's menstruation. And I didn't allow, you know, any answers at the time because I knew that any answers would come from the old paradigm, from the old deception. And many of us admitted already that that the body was cleansing itself of impurities. Am I not correct?
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
I'm going to show y'all what y'all was calling impure about your own bodies. What y'all was calling impure. Remember, we read this now. We read this. Woe to those, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who call light darkness, darkness light, good, evil, bitter for sweet. I'm holding the mirror up. This is what this old paradigm has caused us to do. It's what this old paradigm has caused each and every one of us to do. What the body actually is cleansing itself of, family, is stem cells.
Hmm.
That is biological life.
And they use these stem cells.
Mm-hmm. Listen, stem cells are a class of undifferentiated cells that are able to differentiate into specialized. They can become anything they want to in terms of your body.
Mm-hmm.
They are unformed and uninformed. They can be whatever your body needs, and not just the female through contact the male.
Mm-hmm.
During the menstruation period, life bursts forth from the female. Y'all not hearing me.
Come on, shows.
water and blood. It is cleansing and it is rejuvenating. It is redemptive. It is yes. healing. Commonly, stem cells come from two major sources. Embryos,
mm-hmm.
formed during the blastocyte phase of embryological development, that is in the mother's womb, that these stem cells are in the blood and transferred yes. to the fruit of the womb, to the child. And adult tissue. Both types are generally characterized by their potency. What is another word for potency, beginning with a P? O-W-E-R.
Power. Yes.
Is there power in the blood, family?
Yes. Yes.
Is there life in the blood?
Mm-hmm.
Both types are generally characterized by their potency or power or potential to differentiate into different cell types. They can be, if there's something wrong with your skin can be rejuvenated. Something wrong with your muscles can be healed at that time. Something wrong mm-hmm. with your bones. Can you broke it, you fractured it, can be healed at that time. With what Shows. Is in menstruation blood.
Eitai.
Yes, sir.
Athletes use this process too.
Kobe Bryant.
They go overseas. Yes.
They don't yes. do it. They didn't do it in America. When Kobe Bryant right. had that severe injury, I believe it was yes. In his ankle or something like mm-hmm. that, or his foot.
Mm-hmm.
And Amari Stoudemire, who's in Israel yes. now, that had mm-hmm. surgery on his knee, they went over to Europe and did yes. that stem cell treatment
yes.
to rejuvenate and heal themselves.
Mm-hmm.
We've been deceived, profoundly, profoundly deceived. Look, the research is out. This is why I ask people to research it. Look, all you got to do is Google it now. Oh, I'm sorry. Where is the research?
Ask God. Yeah.
Let me see. Bear with me, family. I thought I kept the article up. Hold on. Well, anyway, oh. Regeneration and adult stem cells in the human, in the female, right, this is it. Regeneration and adult stem cells in the human female reproductive tract. That is the lily of the valley.
Mm.
That is the rose of Sharon. I'm going to prove it.
Come on, Shows.
See, we stopped singing about those things. Now, I'm saying the Christians are still deceived, but they're closer to the truth.
Right. Right. Mm-hmm.
In our traditions, under the old paradigm, under the old template, women are cursed. And the womb is not a subject of conversation. Definitely mm-hmm. not nothing to sing about. I'm not saying that the Christians know what they're singing about either. They're singing about Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And we were deceived to think that when they were singing about power in the blood, that they were singing about the male Jesus. So, of course, we discarded it.
Mm-hmm.
But it got us no closer to the truth. In fact, and in actuality, it moved us further away from the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Regeneration in adult stem cells in human female reproductive tract, the human female reproductive tract, the yoni, the vulva.
The fish.
The human uterus is unique in that it exhibits tremendous regenerative capacity. And look, y'all get brand new stem cells every month. Every time the moon goes through its phases.
Mm-hmm.
That enables cyclical regeneration. That is, you know, according to the moon cycle, and remodeling throughout a woman's reproductive life. This plasticity of the reproductive system has recently been highlighted. Why? Because it was put in the dark.
Yes.
Now, this was published online in 2008, December of 2008. Go back to our prophetic timeline that we've established recently. And what happened in 2008, family?
President Obama.
Absolutely, the end that marked the end of this age.
Mm-hmm.
We got to catch up, y'all.
Mm-hmm.
It's been recently high. Regeneration and remodeling in the female reproductive tract alludes to the existence of endometrial and myometrial stem cell systems, which has been supported by increasing experimental evidence. Characterization of these stem cells, along with the study of the mechanisms controlling their regeneration, will improve the understanding of the physiology of physiology of the female reproductive tract. See, I'm saying our ancient ancestors knew all this. This ain't new.
Yes.
This is not new. Y'all know that they started stem cell banks?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
CryoCell International. Stem cells in menstrual blood have similar regenerative capabilities as the stem cells where? In umbilical cord blood and bone marrow. Didn't I say three umbilical cord, bone?
Mm-hmm.
Well, our ancient ancestors knew it, and it's all throughout the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Our traditions and the old paradigm, family, will not allow us to see it. And we would rather stick to the old traditions then open up our eyes and see what it is that our ancestors left us for such a time.
Yes.
In the transitional phase.
So that would mean the placenta is also that valuable.
Absolutely. And you know what people are doing now?
Taking their placenta and the rest of the umbilical cord with them.
And what are they doing? Do you know what they're doing with it? They're eating it.
Ah,
I thought so. Yes.
I thought so. Yep.
Take, eat. This is my body.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. We're talking about no man.
Mm-hmm.
This is my blood.
This is my blood. CryoCells, patent-pending menstrual stem cell service, offers women in their reproductive years the ability to store and preserve these cells for potential use by herself or a family member. Free from ethical or political controversy. Why was there ethical or political controversy? Because they were using aborted fetuses to get the stem cells. That's why Kobe and them had to go to Europe to do it.
Yes.
Because they didn't have no laws. But because of the fact, family, that not only the Hebrew Israelites, but the whole world was under this false notion, this deception, that the feminine body was cursed through their menstrual cycle, did they ignore for years, centuries, the fact that they could have got this same technology, this same power that is in the blood, free, in an unobtrusive, the flower bloomed every month.
Yes.
I know we done lost some people. Because I don't see them online. I don't know why, but it's either the truth or it's not the truth.
Yeah, it shows. Absolutely.
What are menstrual stems? Stem cells in menstrual blood are highly proliferative and possess the unique ability to develop in various types of healthy tissue. Do you think if we had known this, that we would have put our mothers and daughters and wives through the type of embarrassment?
Mm.
Do you think we would have subjected them to that shame and embarrassment?
No, sir.
Bad thing is there are people we couldn't even say this to now. Before we get all the words out of our mouth, they'll be going, ew, ooh, ooh, ooh.
Right.
Oh, boy.
We got to stop this, family. We got to stop
yes.
it. This is the age yes. of knowledge.
Yes.
CryoCells Menstrual Stem Cell Banking Service. Captures let me ask y'all, y'all should know this. Whose stem cells are the most valuable on this earth?
Melanated people.
Melanated people.
Y'all heard of the movie that's recently out that Oprah Winfrey did on the sister, right?
Yes.
Lax, what's her name?
I know who you're talking about. They use her stem cells and constantly use them.
Yeah, and they made billions of dollars off of it.
Yes.
Didn't give her family none of it.
None of it.
What's her name? Gloria Lax, or I'll put it in here. But we know, right?
Mm-hmm.
Got to come off the old paradigm, family. We got to come out of that. Then they go on to talk about how the whole process of how they collect it, process it, and store it in these what they call cryo vials. Listen to this now and think of the ancient. I want you all to think of the ancient tampon, the tie-yet knot.
Mm-hmm.
The menstrual blood is collected in a physician's office using a medical grade silicone cup in place of a tampon or sanitary napkin. That was the ancient way of doing it.
Mm-hmm.
But they're putting it in a cup, which is another ancient way of doing it. You ever heard of the Holy Grail?
Yes.
The upward, the downward pointing triangle is called the what? The chalice or the cup.
Oh boy.
And again, shows going back to the communion.
Yeah.
That's what they use.
Pass the cup around.
Right.
With the wine.
Drink of it so yep. that you can heal.
And then the bread.
Okay.
Come on, y'all.
Okay, shows that the sister name was Henrietta Lacks.
Henrietta Lacks, I'm sorry. Yes, you're absolutely correct. So let's close, family. Let's move to close here. Transubstantiation is, according to the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church, the change of substance or essence, which the bread and wine offered in the sacrifice or the sacrament of the Eucharist during the Mass,
yes,
became in reality the blood and body, not of Jesus, come on,
mm-hmm.
of Inanna or Isis or the divine feminine. Or the divine feminine. We put our daughters and mothers and wives through a heck of a thing, family.
Yes.
Under deception. Under deception. So I said today that we're going to hold up a mirror to ourselves. This is what this was about. We have to distinguish between what is true and valid and what is false and invalid. This scientific, perceptual, social engineering is something that is powerful and profoundly far-reaching. Is it not?
Can show.
What we're going to touch on next time is the sacred power of menstrual blood, reclaiming our wise blood.
Mm-hmm.
And this came out March 27th of this year.
Wow.
March
27th. That ain't coincidence, shows.
It ain't no coincidence, man.
No. Mm-mm.
And on July 27th.
Right.
We had the full blood moon eclipse.
Wow.
I'm going to show you all how we're right on time. Look. Y'all know Wonder Woman came out this year as well, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And she had the Rose of Sharon on her head.
Mm-hmm.
The eight-pointed star of Saturn. Which is a representation of the divine yoni, the lotus flower, the rose of Sharon, the lily of the valley. And here you see Ra rising out, being born again from the water box, from the lotus. The facts don't lie, family.
Come on, shows. Absolutely not.
Facts don't lie. And then you all, I want you all to notice when we come back next time, we talked about the event of the full blood moon, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right after that, what happened? The Lionsgate portal opened up. Look at what Inanna is standing on.
Come on, show.
Right on line.
Yes. See the owls.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Do you see the tie-out knots?
Yes.
That she has in her hand. Come on, hey, our ancestors are speaking to us.
Mm-hmm. Loud and clear, shows.
Y'all see?
When are you sending that out? I'm on the phone right now, and I miss seeing it.
Well, you'll look at it, but do you see her standing as Isis was standing,
mm-hmm.
with her hands outstretched?
Yes.
The two things together.
Mm-hmm.
What are the brothers doing? And the serving her.
Mm-hmm.
This is the bark of that. You know, this is the vehicle that she's empowering. The ascension vehicle. Look at the brother.
Yeah.
Yippee-yi-yo, Ty. He getting ready to rise. We're going to talk about all this, family.
Absolutely.
Yes. This is our time. Now,
no question.
Hey, people can stay stuck on stupid if they want to. Not me.
Yes. Yes.
Not me.
Not me. Me neither, shows.
Not at all. Ooh. You know, my given birth name is Sharon, right?
Absolutely, Sharon. We got
for
a couple of Sharon.
70, the 70 plus years. And my nonprofit is ROSE, is the acronym, and it stands for Rose of Sharon Empowerment Global Outreach Ministry.
Come on, you right on time.
Mm-hmm.
And yes. I have a picture that I took one Halloween when I was a bit younger in the Wonder Woman costume.
Come on now.
Hey. I made it.
Look.
Because everybody told me when I was in the Air Force, and I had those big glasses like Diana Prince on the Wonder Woman.
Come on.
So I started looking at it because they kept telling me, "You look like Wonder Woman. You look like Wonder Woman." So my children grew up with that. So when Wonder Woman came out, my youngest daughter took me and her two sons to see the premiere, it opened. And I had the bracelets and everything. Didn't know I really had the power. I wanted to add this other thing. You mentioned Lily of the Valley earlier.
Yes.
A little earlier. There's a song, God Can Do Anything But Fail, and in it says, the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, will heal your body wherever you are.
That's correct.
So I guess that's with whatever you need, wherever you are, because since you just revealed about the stem cells can turn into whatever they need to be.
Yes,
they can be whatever they need to be. Mm.
We gotta free ourselves, family.
Free
ourselves from the old paradigm. We got to free ourselves from the old paradigm. All right. Are we good?
Oh, shows.
We are too. We are super.
We did.